Yeah.
Good, good. Right, okay. So we're going to go in 3, 2, 1. Lions Lounge Lockdown, episode 21. Paul Stephenson, thanks for joining us, mate.
My lucky number, 21.
There you go. That's why I've waited to keep you back till then.
Number 7 and number 21. Hi, everyone. Nice to meet everybody again. Brilliant club. Fans are amazing. It's actually the one club I go back to, and I still feel like it was just yesterday.
Brilliant. It was some really good times we made at the club. Before we get on to you joining Millwall, obviously you came through the ranks. It all sort of intertwines anyway, but you came through the ranks from a Geordie lad and through the ranks at your hometown club.
Yeah, came through with, we had a great team. We're still the Newcastle United side to win the Youth Cup. And it gets brought up every year when the Youth Cup's on. So I always have a laugh about it. The same photo goes in the Evening Chronicle every year. But we had a good set of lads. Brian Tinian, Gazza, Ian Bogie, Jeff Wrightson went on to play professionally, Joe Allen, Gary Kelly, Kevin Scott. I mean, to be honest, that showed how good a team that was. We were all still playing league football in my 30s. Mm. So it was quite a good group. It was a great group to come through with, because we all dragged each other up to like the higher level, you know. So it was a good, and we had some fun along the way with Gazza, you can imagine some of the stories. Fucking hell. Crazy. He was a cracker.
It was even worse when he was younger.
Oh, he's mad. I mean, some of the stuff, I mean, just one, for instance, I mean, he must have not made Billy Whitehurst, who you wouldn't not make Billy Whitehurst, because he's like, you know, he's a big bloke and he's hard as nails, as everyone knows. And he's not megged him twice, and he's gone, you do that again, I'm going to bop you. And he's megged him from like 10 yards and shouted it, like looking the other way, and passed it through his legs. Billy's like bopped him, and then later on he's had some like words back to Billy and vice versa. And Billy's like chased him into the back of the training ground, and the kit man Brian Clark's running after it to protect Gazza, and Billy's looking around and he can't find Gazza anywhere, and it's like a dead end, and like can't find him anywhere. So anyway, Brian goes walking in afterwards. About 5 minutes later, the big old tumble dryers. Brian's got to get the kit out, and a hand just came out of the tumble dryer. He'd been going round in the tumble dryer for 5 minutes on like the hot heat, you know, the hottest sort of temperature, you know. And that was him, like that was, and then he actually got a liking for it. He used to try and get us to do it, and another lad called Ollie, bless him, who's not a lad with me now, he would gladly get in and shut the door, didn't put it on like hot, it'd be on cold, and close the door, and they'd be going round
so Gazza was basically saying, boys, jump on this, it's good, it's good fun.
It was something he could do, and he probably just got a giggle out of it, you know what I mean? Because he used to just do daft things all the time. I mean, there wasn't one lunchtime where somebody went like that with a salt or pepper and just totally wrecked their dinner, because he somehow got in and loosened all the tops on the salt and peppers. And you couldn't basically relax at any stage with him about, because he was up to something. Mm. So you're on your tours. I'd probably give him a good awareness, because we're always on the lookout for what he's up to next, you know.
Always on your toes. Yeah, so I say, we've been covering the 90s at Millwall recently on the show, and I stumbled across, Ian Bogie got a few mentions, and we stumbled across the picture that we spoke about before we went on air.
You,
Ian Bogie, and Gazza. What was Bogie like? Great player as well, by the way.
Bogues was brilliant. Still keep in touch with Bogues a lot. I'm pleased for him. He's actually coaching at Newcastle now. And he's had a couple of tough years where he wasn't working, and you know, he was finding it difficult to get back in. But he's working with the 18s at Newcastle now, and he's just a brilliant lad. He's so funny. He's like a real dry sense of humour, Ian. But again, a bit of a trickster as well. He'll go into joke shops and, you know, he'll get like electric pens, and you know, he's got like taking the Wrigley spearmint gum, and you get electric shocks and all that. And just crackers, you know. I know Gazza rubbed up on him because, believe it or not, when we were apprentices, Gazza lived with Ian for 2 years. He wasn't living at home. I don't know if his mum and dad knew where he was. Living with Ian for 2 years at Ian's house, and he used to come into train with us. So he lived round the corner from me basically for a couple of years, and
yeah,
just a lunatic, but fun, good fun, you know.
So it's a very, you know, it's an answer only you can give us. So you played for obviously the famous Wolves End Boys Club in Newcastle growing up, yeah. Geordie boy, born and bred. Newcastle's your hometown club. You signed obviously contract with them, win the Youth Cup, as you said, play with some unbelievable players. But then in 1988, you decide for whatever reason to make the move south to Millwall. Was that a difficult decision? And why did you make it?
Yeah, it was a difficult decision. But what happened was in between, I don't think Millwall ever, fans ever saw the best of us. I think Newcastle did in that first season I played, because I was just probably, I wouldn't say as quick as Jimmy, but I wasn't far off, especially off the mark. And I had a really bad... I played the last 23 games from when I got in that team. Got Young Player of the Year. Played in the end-of-season game for Newcastle because there were short of players in the reserves after playing the last 23 games of the season in the first team, and got a horrendous injury. And I wouldn't say I'd never forgive them for it. I did. It wasn't a case of that. But it left a little bit of a bitter taste because I had to come back from it took us a long time. You talked about an injury, dislocated did all the ligaments on the front of my ankle, stretching for a ball on the byline. And it took us a good 6 to 8 months to get back. And even for a year after that, I still played with pain. I just wore a strap in. And, you know, Derek Wright, bless him, who's still there, and he did loads of work with us over the summer. I missed all my summer holidays. I didn't have a trip with the lads and I had all lined up. So I missed out on all that. And then I come back from injury and they signed John Hendry from Bradford, I think, and Peter Jackson. And they didn't really offer us a new contract because I'd had the injury a bit. And I got back in the team and I was playing really well again. And they still, I was on a week-to-week. And obviously Millwall were savvy to this. And I must admit, I think at the time, I know they were struggling a bit, but I think I was 5 or 6 man the matches at St. James's. I was really going well again. And Newcastle didn't come up with an offer until Millwall came in. And just me and my dad, who obviously he's not wooing now, bless him, but at the time we just thought, nah, why is someone come in before they've like offered us this? And when there was lads would come in like John and they were getting miles better money and I was keeping out with the team. So it was a little bit of that.
So they took you for granted a little bit because you was homegrown, because you come through the ranks. They thought,
we'll get him for now. He's got black and white eyes, and then I got a phone call off John Doherty. Came up to Central Station that the next day or that night. I can't remember, it was that long ago. And with Bob Pearson, and me and my dad went up the hotel up there across the road from it. Just sat and talked football, no money, just talked football, everything about football, wanting to know how he was looking for us to play. I knew they had Cascarino and Sheringham, and I was sort of, I would say, coached a lot in Newcastle, like, can you get your cross in, can you get it in early? You know, the game was a bit different then, I think, to where it is now, and they have white players in off the line. We sort of hugged the line a bit in them days and had to beat my man and put a good delivery in. And it really whet my appetite thinking about, you know, them two. I didn't know loads about them, I must admit.
Yeah.
They'd come through the leagues and I knew they were doing well. And and he said, I've seen you play and you put great balls in and, you know, we've got two big lads, they'll relish it. And he sold the club there and then. And then obviously went down with great terms and it was off and away.
Did you come... I mean, in my head, I've dreamt it that you literally went on the pitch at Anfield, come straight from Newcastle to Liverpool, didn't even go to London and just scored straight away. Or did you move down to London and then travel back up with the how long after you signed was?
I think I came up with the team. I'm sure I came up with the team. It's a long time ago, and obviously in between that, I've had a nasty accident in Brentford where I had a fractured skull, so I've lost quite a few memories. Funny enough.
Right.
But I can remember obviously the big ones like that in particular. And I went down, I'm sure, on the midweek, trained a couple of years, came back with the squad. My family drove down from Newcastle, my girlfriend at the time, and me mum, and they went, and my dad, and they all went the game, and then I went back with them after the game.
Right.
I cleared up with the doc, you know.
Was you not, like, did it not faze you? I mean, how old was you at this point? You must have been early 20s, mustn't you?
So it was 89, so I was 21.
Did it not faze you just going down to London?
Not really. I mean, in all honesty, 2 weeks earlier, I'd played for Newcastle at Anfield, and we won 2-1. Played the full 90. Mirandina scored a penalty at the cop end. He was giving it one of them signs to the cop end when he scored. He nearly got killed. Bless him. And I'd been there a couple of years earlier on my second game for Newcastle, and we drew 1-3. So I had no fears of Anfield. I actually had an unbelievable game on my second game when I was a kid, when I first got in the team against Jim Beglin, and had a really good game that night or that afternoon. And then a couple of years later, I'd gone back and won, like I say, 2-1. So I had no fears of Anfield.
Not moving to London, did that not faze you at all as a 21-year-old? Just stepping out of your comfort zone, just moving south? Or did you not really?
I don't think, because we didn't have the social media and all that, you don't really overthink it, you know. I wanted to play. I wanted to be getting, you know, a decent pay for my services, because Newcastle hadn't really done that at the time. And they're quite happy for us to just tick along on less money, you know.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to play. I loved playing. I've ended up being a coach after playing. I wasn't really one that loved training, to be honest. I just loved games.
Yeah.
I'd be a nightmare now trying to play in front of no crowd, because I think the bigger the crowd, the better the buzz. And I always felt like I could rise even better, you know, to the hostility, let's say, you know. Mm-hmm. But it was a whirlwind of a week, I must admit, but it was brilliant. And then the little follow on from that is I've obviously come back down to Millwall a couple of days later, maybe it's a Tuesday, whatever, the doc gives a couple of days at home just to get myself going again. And my next game at home was against Newcastle at the Old Den. And we won 4-0.
Yeah, I know, yeah. Let's take it back, though. So what was your first impressions of the club, London, your teammates?
Yeah. Well, I knew Brian Horn, and I knew Neil Ruddock from the England under 18 days. So I'd sort of met up with them and I'd come through a little bit with them. And so I knew them too. I actually was down, and I think my dad might have been with us. There was a game the midweek before the Liverpool game in the like Synod Cup or something like that. And I think Neil Ruddock scored an unbelievable, like a screamer, like 35 yarder. And it was a game after, in between. And it was a penalty shootout, and Brian Horn saved every penalty. So he saved every penalty. I think they scored 3 and that was it. He saved 4. It's unbelievable, Horny. But he was brilliant at penalties, wasn't he? I mean, he was such a, you know, he was a bit of a cat, wasn't he? So it was like a whirlwind the way, like I say, how it went on. And then we had the Newcastle game. Mum and dad came down for that. And me girlfriend. And brilliant. Great result. Wouldn't happen these days. But we didn't get out of the doc's office until after midnight. Us four. Teddy and his girlfriend, Denise, I think. Cass and his wife. And just sat there drinking, and my mum let it slip that I was a good entertainer and I could sing, because I'd sung in schools and plays and all that at school. So that was it. Doc, we loved it. Had us up singing. A few more beers later, because we just won Newcastle. And by the end of the night, him and Frank were doing Underneath the Arches, Flanagan and Allen, with me mum's fur coat on, the two of them. It was... It was absolutely brilliant. I mean, it won't happen these days. No chance. But
how many of you were in there, that office? Must have been a big office.
Yeah, it was just the doc's office, but he always had a nice... He made sure his bar was well stocked. And we were there. It must have been after midnight. So it was a long day, but it was brilliant. Brilliant memory.
Let's talk about let's talk about it in more detail, if you don't mind, about the Liverpool game. Your Millwall debut will always be an iconic goal in Millwall's history. So so that is funny. I spoke to Hornley and I said that season, that was our first season in the top division, but it didn't really feel like we properly had a strong away game until that day. Mm. And it was your debut. What do you remember about making your debut, the game, the goal? Talk us through everything.
Yeah. I was a bit surprised I was starting, to be honest. Because I think either Jimmy or George Lawrence had been playing. And I'm not even sure that Doc... I think he just named the team on the day. And I was like a little bit like, oh, I'm playing, get in. I wasn't fazed. I just thought, get in, I want to play, you know? Yeah. So, it was just if you look back on his career, Teddy, I mean, we could all see it then how good he was, because we saw it every day in training. And he was just, you know, light years ahead of the rest of the lads in that team, you know what I mean? Because he was just... He was a second or whatever ahead of everybody, because he knew where everybody was. He had that, like, you know, he radar. He was brilliant. Mm. If you just look at Ted's setup from that goal, it was just like, it was so much similar. I was watching it the other day.
I know what you're going to say. Shearer. You're going to say Euro 96.
Euro 96. He just goes like that, and he just says, stick it in the net, mate. And obviously Shearer slams it in a bit closer in. I think he's about 10 yards out. And I might edge of the box, obviously, roundabout when he hits it. But it was just set lovely for just say hit it, you know. And I'm not going to say I aim for this, I aim for that. Just hit the back of the ball as hard as I could, and it just rocketed in, you know. So happy days. Went crazy. Me missus damaged herself, and me mum, like, in with the Millwall fans, and it just went ballistic, you know. So. Bloody noses and all sorts all over the place.
Callan, Riley, and now a chance for Sheringham. Stephenson, and he scored! Stephenson has scored on his debut! And over to our left, that's the Millwall crowd and the cop. You can hear a pin drop. Paul Stephenson, 10 minutes, a Millwall player, and he's scored.
Your mum and your missus were in the Millwall end.
Aye, they went in there with my dad and that as well. So, and they loved it. They loved it. See the Geordies as well. You know, I could have went to somewhere boring. I mean, you probably know a boring team in London, but there's some quiet teams, isn't it? But it felt a bit home from home, really, because Newcastle fans are cracker jacks. I was just like, I used to call them the Southern Geordies. The Millwall fans are just crackerjacks as well, aren't they? So it was like being used to that, onto this now, you know? So
yeah, perfect fit. That's been a dream start, though. 10 minutes into your debut, you weren't expecting to start. You come for quite big money, £300,000. So there was obviously a level of expectancy there.
Yeah. Without a doubt. And I did feel a lot of times, especially... It wasn't like it is now. We didn't get paid the money that they do now. You could do what you want now. You could buy your own house near the training ground. Or I actually stayed in Slough for 3 or 4 months with Bob Pearson. So I was travelling. You talked about a lad who was getting... I was getting a bus most of my career. And then I was getting... then I got myself a little car. And it was only like 15 minutes from my house to the training ground, Newcastle.
Mm.
And now I'm driving. Now I'm driving like... Now and a half, 2 hours to get to training. And
you couldn't get any further away from South London, really, Slough. It's just a nightmare, isn't it?
And it took us a while to really, you know. But I think it definitely hit me form. I was flying to start with, and then it definitely affected us. And then when I got Alan McCleary, was living in Welling, and he said, what about coming to Welling? Like, he had a little look around there. and end up living not far from the corner, Bradnam Avenue in Welling, next to Allen.
That's where I live. I live in Welling.
Oh, do you? Yeah. Well, that's where I met Dave Donovan as well. Obviously, fantastic friend of mine, and Sandra's, all the family, wonderful family. And I moved to Welling, and it just made it easier again. I felt like my form was starting to pick up again. You know, sitting in a car for 3-4 hours a day isn't really ideal for like a footballer, is it? You know what I mean? When you think about your travelling. But yeah, it made a big difference for sure.
So you was a right winger. You could play on the left if need be. You did alternate sometimes between Kelly and Jimmy. You know, no disrespect to you, but Jimmy Carter was a massively well respected Millwall player when you signed. So was you aware? What did the doc want? Competition for places or?
No, I wasn't aware of it, to be honest. I would say if I was a right winger. I was a midfield player all the way through junior football. And then obviously, as I got into this Newcastle sort of senior ranks, I did play right wing. And I really was suited to playing right wing in them first few years before I had my bad injury, because I was really quick and I could go on the outside of people for fun. I think as I slowed down, I had to start playing on the left a little bit more times and have to play with people inside the pitch as well a bit more, because you haven't quite got that pace to get down the line. But I could still clip the ball with my left foot, so I could always go there or come in there and maybe have a shot. So I think I was quite adaptable in that. I mean, I finished my career playing deep midfield player at Hartlepool for 4 years in a three with Mark Tinkler and Tommy Miller when Tommy was starting his career. So and I loved that. I loved that because I was involved in the game all the time. Whereas playing wide, you're sort of dependent on service a bit. But I still loved it. I mean, and as I say, I had some good targets. And then obviously we've got Malcolm Allen came in. So once Cass left, we had a different type of player. Mally was brilliant to play around the corner with, you know, play 1-2s with, pass it and follow in it. And I think it gave a little bit of a different dimension as well when Mally came in. So, but like I say, there was a lot of good players at the club. So
well, I was going to get onto that now, talk about the players that were at the club, obviously. Yeah. The front two you've mentioned, but Les Brierley and Terry in the centre of midfield. What did you know? Again, going back to the doc, what did he sell it to you as? You know, we've just come up, but we're pretty sure we're going to be there or thereabouts for a couple of years. Or did he say, look, we're up against it? Or how did he?
I think from what I could recall, I would say he was pretty bullish about certainly the first season. I think he believed they could stay up. We could stay up the top end of the table for quite a while. I think we all sort of probably didn't have the depth in squad that you probably needed that little, as you've seen throughout the season. But I don't think he never ever was negative in that sense and sort of talked about, you know, the lower end or going down or anything like that. I think the year we did go down, we didn't. How we went down, I don't know. I mean, some of the games were battered teams. We just couldn't seem to stick it in the net, you know. It was just weird. Amount of times we got mugged, but we did. And that's probably the only disappointment I had at Millwall. That and the playoffs the following year, when we got beat off Brighton. Throughout the year. So.
Oh, no, I watched them clips earlier. You scored a good goal that day as well. We'll get on to that in a bit. So first season, obviously your debut is an absolute dream. What other games sort of stood out for you in that season? You can remember any, or just talk about it.
I think, I don't know if it was the season after. I think obviously the West Ham was a big game because, you know, I hadn't really played in the derby at Newcastle. I played Newcastle and Middlesbrough, not Newcastle Sunderland. So it was a proper... You know, Newcastle Sunderland would have been, you know, vicious. But especially in them days, probably not so much now. But Newcastle Middlesbrough was a good game and we beat them 2-0 comfortably. But that was my first real sort of taste of a proper sort of derby, I think, Millwall West Ham, because of the love that they have for each other, let's say. and then I was lucky enough to score on that one. So... quarter of the pitch, really, on the left side, felt it was, and half volleyed it, flew in.
Taken by Keith Stevens. Stevens again. Nice ball, back to Wood. That's a good cross. Foster just got the touch. Oh, a great shot. Oh, what a goal! A fantastic goal from Paul Stephenson. And you won't see a better finish than that. The ball was crossed from the right. Colin Foster just nudged it away with his head. And in came Paul Stephenson to rocket that shot in from 20 yards. And it gave McCloskey no chance at all.
Yeah, probably them games in the playoff games. You kind of do remember the bigger games, I think, you know. But we had a lot of games where I think we beat Chelsea. And I think, you know, Mali scored a great goal. I remember just getting eyes with him, clipping a free kick, and he had a one-on-one. The keeper all went to sleep. But we just, how we went down that year, I think it was a bit of a puzzle, really, to all, because we really did. We did play some good stuff despite going down at times, you know.
Yeah, but we kept the same squad together in the second season, in the top flight. Maybe we should have added to it. Brian also, Hawley said to me that
we should have kept Doc.
Yeah, well, he obviously lost his job, and Hawley said that he felt it was his loyalty ended up costing him a job because he was so loyal to you boys as players.
Right.
That he didn't, maybe he should have made changes in the second season, and he didn't, and he ends up. Do you remember when he lost his job?
Vaguely, but again, I remember who come in after him. Brucey.
Yeah. So Bob Pearson takes over till the end of sort of the final 10 games.
Yeah.
We get relegated in our first season back in, which would now be the Championship. Bruce Rioch. We've heard a lot of stories, not many positive ones, I'm not going to lie. What's he like for you, Bruce?
Just weird. I just found him weird. Obviously, I'd be knackered now. He'd be all right at the top of my head, clean shaven, more or less. But, he had to be clean shaven. And I think Terry Hurlock only lasted one day. He had to come in clean shaven, and he said something to Terry, and Terry said something back, and then next thing you know, Terry's left. Like, gone, it lasted 24 hours, Terry. He's lucky Terry didn't chin him, I suppose. But he was weird, Bruce. I felt like I had a couple of good, really good runs under him. I was playing really well at one stage for him, and he wouldn't talk to you. He wouldn't even like the talk about man management and all them sort of skills. I felt like I'm playing really well here, but he doesn't even speak to you hardly. You know, it's as though you like Harry used to say, I think I've run his cat over. Harry used to say that, yeah, I think I've run his cat over.
Was he like sort of a little bit of a school teacher student feel about it?
Aye, he's very sergeant major, I would say, definitely. And apparently his dad was that background, but you know, obviously after being in management with senior and young sort of professionals and young players, you've got to man manage the group that you've got, you know. And our group was pretty hurly burly group of men, you know, Terry and Les and Harden pros and seasoned pros, Dorsey, who I love, great, you know, I love my favourite fullback to play behind us. I love Dorsey. Had a good little relationship, and he didn't man manage the group for me. It was his way or the highway, and you don't get the best out of people like that, you know. Somebody might need a little bit of a rattle, but other people need a cuddle, you know. And you've got to sort of work out which ones need which to get the best out of them. And he didn't like. And I don't think anybody was disappointed when the axe came down.
Well, in the first, say he's like, you know, his first season, it's never an easy job to get a team back first time of asking. But we nearly did it. A lot of the players that I spoke to from your era and this sort of this team said that Steve Harrison sort of bridged the gap.
He was
a great coach, and he sort of bridged the gap. And then, what was he like? Yeah. We've heard so many funny stories already, but
Harry's probably the one guy, definitely the major coach that I really enjoyed training. And I think we all did because it was fun, and but it was engaging as well. We felt, you know, like all them lads will have been at different clubs where you're sort of guessing how you're playing, but you knew how you were playing because we had a pattern. We knew how we were. If I got it there, he was going to be there. And, you know, if I popped that there and he set it off, somebody else was going to be, like Alex was going to be run beyond. We did a lot of work on the training ground. And you took that into your games. And actually under Bruce Rioch, I love the football we played at times. I think we played some great football. Mm. It was enjoyable to play in. It was entertaining at times as well. I think we got plenty of goals that season. Obviously, Teddy got, I think the year we got in the playoffs, Ted got, I think it was 7-2 to get a hat-trick at one stage. He was scoring that many hat-tricks.
He scored three. Well, I've got him in notes here. He got 38 goals, that league goal.
Yeah, 38 goals, yeah. I said I wanted 23 assists for them 38. He was happy to give us them. But to be fair, you laughed, don't you? 23 assists or whatever it was that year. That was just Ted. But a winger makes like two goals now and they've got two assists in 2 years. And you think, what's happening? Like, that's not meant to be your job description. You're meant to be creating goals, you know?
No, exactly.
But Ted was unplayable that year. I mean, he was actually 7-2 with the bookies to score a hat-trick at one stage because he was just knocking everybody. I mean, he scored a great hat-trick against Charlton on a night game, I can remember. You could see he had that arrogance about him, Ted, you know, and I mean that in a nice way because Ted's one of them people, he always seems to me, if he knows you, he's great with you, but if he doesn't know you, he's probably just a bit wary. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. But he's a lovely lad. A couple of years ago, I took my golf trolley and my mate, and he used it in this competition. And he took the trolley. He got the trolley through it. But he did it for now, you know, which was a brilliant gesture for me and mate's company. And just shows, like, Ted, you know, he's a cracking kid, like.
So. And then another great player. I mean, I'm looking at these players we had and thinking, oh, you know, we went close in the playoffs, which we'll get on to shortly. But the players we had, we probably should have won the league, really. Alex Ray, Malcolm Allen. What was he like? Yeah. There was quite a double act, I've heard.
Without a doubt. Oh, I them two, God. I think they could have drunk everywhere dry. But they were different. I couldn't do that. I mean, we all had a drink in them days. But, you know, I was one of them, I could drink at the right time. But them lads could drink and play. Probably played better. You know, I mean, I don't know how they did it. You know, Bruce used to let us have a jug of beer on a Friday night, some away games, just to say, have a couple of glasses if you want and help you sleep, you know. But they'd probably take it to the next level and have got, well, you know, plenty of pints. But they'd still be playing the next day and you're thinking, well, I couldn't do that, like, so.
Yeah.
Everyone's different on this one.
Yeah, exactly. So we make the playoffs that year. We finish, I think, fourth. I think Brighton finished fifth. So we faced them at the Goldson ground in the first leg. What do you remember about that day? I watched the highlights earlier. That was quite an implosion, should we say.
We actually, I think if I remember right, I don't know if you watched the highlights. We're 1-0 up. I scored it. Did we have one cancelled after that?
John Goodman, they didn't show it in the highlights, but John Goodman previously said that he was
2-0. Maybe John or Teddy put, I think it might have been Ted, put I whipped a free kick in from the left and just above head eight, Ted come across the front of someone. And I still, to this day, I've seen a couple of things, I don't understand why it was cancelled or like, you know, ruled out. And that would have been 2-0, but then obviously. Then we just had a crazy sort of.
Hang on, don't brush over a bit of glory for you. A brilliant goal.
I mean, just had one thing in my mind. Just, you know, got it. I was going to cut inside and hit it, and I caught it well. But I think it's a way of just dipping in front of the keeper, and you know, probably keeper maybe should have done better, to be honest. But I wasn't thinking of that, and that was off and away, and it was brilliant.
Just coming up to 15 minutes gone. Still, Brighton 0, Millwall 0. Now Stephenson on the left, but he favours his right foot, as you can see. Very sweetly struck by Paul Stephenson. And it dipped just at the right moment for Millwall, but not for Digweed.
Yeah, it was a perfect start, away from home, 1-0 up. Like I say, I think when we spoke on the phone about before the interview, from what I remember, I'm sure we beat them 3-0 that year, and maybe just 1-0, but comfortably took care of them throughout the regular season. Mm. I don't know if that played against us in the playoffs, you know what I mean? Subliminally, did we think we're going to just crack it, you know? But we just had a nutty 10 minutes, and that was... It's almost like game was gone.
I actually laughed when I watched their equaliser where Dave Thompson tries to duck out and hits him on the back of the head and just falls. He was another big Geordie lad, wasn't he, Dave Thompson? Is he from your...
Dave, he was my roomie for my first few games there. He was a great lad. Mad as a hatter. Proper mad. I think we all mad then, weren't we?
I think it sounds like a bit of a Geordie theme, yeah.
That's probably the most sensible where I was crackers. Dave was a great lad, really good lad. He had a couple of he played well when he got in the team. I remember the funny game I remember for Dave was we played Wimbledon, and he was all like psyched up about, you know, playing against John Fashanu, he's gonna hit him and all that. And he hit him quite, you know, he got stuck into a big Fash like early on. He got stretched out, I think, about 20 minutes later. I think Fash had just given, well, a couple of bingos, you know, because he, obviously, they were tasty. He could certainly look out for himself.
What was Sergeant Major Reok's reaction at full time when you've come in and been trounced 4-1 in the first leg of the playoffs?
I'll be honest with you, I don't even think you hear anything when you're a player. you're just so gutted, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think what I do remember quite vividly when we were talking about it the other day, and I've had a good think about it, we absolutely caned them in the second leg. How we didn't wipe out that lead in the first 20 minutes, I don't know. I put a very rare sweet left foot cross in, because I would get across him with my left foot, but it would tend to be more floaty. But I actually chopped it down the line and whipped a great ball in, drilled it across. John McGinn scored early. Crow was up.
Got Stephenson away on the left. Alex Ray's in the middle. Needless to say, Sheringham's in there too. Dawes coming up to help him out. The cross comes in. And it might come to McGinley now. It's in there! The breakthrough that Millwall desperately needed has come from young John McGinley. Where was the Brighton marking? Just inside the far post. The delight as the Millwall player picks it out of the net. And we really have a cup tie on our hands now.
So a 4-2 on aggregate, and you think, oh, whatever it was, 3, was it?
Yeah, 4-2. That's 4-2 on aggregate, isn't it?
That's right, because it's 4. And you're thinking, oh, here we go. And then I remember, I'm sure I took about 5 or 6 corners in a row. I was knackered because I was running across there, and I was coming back across here. We think we had one that went over the line off a Dave Thompson header. I was pulling them with the top bins and that, and you're thinking, Christ, you know what I mean? For Christ's sake, you know, like, get that second. And because we didn't get it, we just went in 1-0 half time.
Mm.
I think it just, then they nick one on the counter, and that was it. You know, ripped the stuffing out. Where I think we just imploded a bit after that. Had we got them second off, even a second goal, maybe 4 half time, I think it was definitely on.
Yeah.
To come back, you know, but.
It was, you know, the following season, Bruce and yourselves must have thought, okay, we fell short there, but we could have a real go here. Pretty much kept the same side together. Obviously, we lost Teddy at that point, which would have been a major blow. But if you look at the players that come in that summer, Colin Cooper, Chris Armstrong, your mate Ian Bogey, Casey Keller, Etienne Vivia. You know, we strengthened, really. It should have got better, but it got a whole lot worse very quickly.
Yeah, maybe, yeah. Like I say, when did Mick come in then? Did Mick not come in that season?
He come in. Bruce was the manager up until a point where, I've checked this out as well, we lost 6-1 at Portsmouth. You wasn't involved that day.
No.
But then the next day...
Thank God for that, 6-1.
Yeah, he wasn't involved. He wasn't on the bench or anything. But the next game, we won 1-0 at home to Port Vale. You started that game, and then the rest until the end of the season. So had you fallen out of Bruce at this point, or
every chance? Because he probably taught us at that stage. By then, yeah, he wouldn't talk to us when I was playing up your skin. But then, when you're not playing, he was like your best pal, and you're like, "Fuck it, what have I done to him?" Like, you just didn't know whether you're coming or going with Bruce. He was a strange, definitely strange. But the Paul Vale game, the thing about that was, and I mean, mate, Dave Donovan, who you know, his boy Paul was the mascot for that game, and come running out, and I got recalled back for that game with 1-1-0. He sent me a video the other day of like him taking a video of the game and that. And like you say, I had a good run back in the team. I got on great with Mick, to be fair.
Yeah.
And only when my contract sort of ran out did Mick took over. Bit of a bad advice off my agent, really. I wish I'd re-signed another couple of years. I binned my agent after that. I did all my own sort of contracts after that. I didn't have an agent after that because he really sort of gave us poor advice, basically.
So was you out of the team for a reason through Bruce or just...
Yeah, probably out of form, I would guess, but don't know if I'd been injured or not. I can't remember, to be honest. It's that long ago. But again, nice to come back in the team for that game. And, you know, it was, you know, my best pal down in London, his laddies, I ran out with him and I was kicking the ball with him and they were great memories. I definitely remember that game.
When Mick comes in, I bet the players were relieved, were they? Was you expecting that?
Yeah,
first managerial job.
I got on brilliant with Mick when we're both players. Really going well with him. Even when I watch him now, I love watching him talk. I think he's a great talker. He's just straight as a die. As it happens, obviously, he had me little contract wranglings, and then he decided to play a different formation. He went and played a diamond, which I was a wide player. Didn't quite fit in it. He had more midfield players in it. And that's how he sort of worded it. And I got a chance to go down the road because I couldn't play. I could play it for my fitness, but again, back to no crowds. Millwall Resies against Crystal Palace Resies and that just didn't tickle me much, you know. So I had to... Glenn Roder had just took over at Gillingham and they were really struggling down the road and come in for us. And I said, he rang us up. I said, I'll come play. Two leagues down, but I went and had a great 3 months. I was initially going to go for a month. There were 6 points adrift at the bottom of the league, the fourth division, let's say.
Yeah.
And by the time I left, there were about 7-8 points above the relegation. So I had a good run. Got me moved to Brentford through it. Kind of enjoyed it and didn't with Brentford because the first season I went there, I only played a couple of games, did me groin. Missed the rest of the last 7 games of the season. I think I lost 6 or all 7 and ended up being in the next league below. So, and then David Webb came in and I really enjoyed my time with David Webb. He was a really good manager.
So when you left Millwall, I mean, you was on loan at Gillingham. When you came back, was you aware of the situation then? Did Mick say, you know, your contract's up, we're not going to renew it? Or did you get offered a contract?
No, I never got re-offered. I would have signed the original offer, but I didn't get it re-offered. They'd come in for us. I think I went for like 30 grand plus a sell-on fee, which, you know, I thought was good value for them, Brentford. But again, I think I just had a bit of I could have done even better, I think, at Brentford had I not just got the injuries, because I was really getting myself going at Brentford. I'd snapped a bit of bone off the back of my left ankle. Took us a bit while to get over that. And then I fractured my skull, double depressed fracture, up with Bradford. And I was touch and go. I was in a ward with three people in infirmary in Bradford. The other two died. So I was at touch and go. Yeah, I was touch and go. So didn't play for 3 months. People said I shouldn't play again, but I said, no, I've got to play. That's me living. I want to play. Mm-hmm. I was back playing 3 months later. So
3 months?
3 months later, aye. Jesus. And I've got a big dent in my head. It's like square here. Yeah, come back playing, and then I was still playing. Got through to playing when I was 35. I was about 27 then.
You had a very good career, over 500 career appearances. So you had injuries at different points, but you always came back.
To be honest, I think 700 easily if I hadn't had any injuries. Mm. And I'd like to think I could have played a bit, you know, a little bit higher level, a little bit longer. But you get injuries and you just got to accept them. But I think because I'd had that injury from such a young age, when I was 17, 18 in Newcastle, it sort of prepared us a little bit for injuries. And I came back from that one. And I think mentally, I thought, you know, I always found it knuckled down, I can come back again. And I did. I snapped my arm at York a bit later in my career. Just before we're playing, a few weeks before playing Man United in the Coca-Cola Cup. Missed that game. The lads won 3-0 in Old Trafford. Got beat 2-0 at home, but went through. And then I played with like a special caster put on. There's the arm there. Where you can see where it's snapped. Yeah. I've kept the plates in. And I played with that on. And I played in the next game. We beat Everton over two legs, but they played all the big hitters because we'd beat Man United. But we beat them quite comfortably. Drew ones each of their Goodison. Beat them there 2-3-1 at our place. So, it was just part of my career, I think, being injured. But you've got to come through them, haven't you?
Yeah, mate, you've done well. You say you had a very, very good career. Going back to Millwall, if you could pick sort of a couple of standout memories and dressing room stories, is there anything you could think of that the viewers might like to hear?
I was trying to think of a good, like a funny one, you know. Well, I remember we were, it might have been the end of my first season. It was the year, I'll tell you when it was. It was when Arsenal won 2-0 at Liverpool. So I think it was, because we all watched it in Malaysia quite late. We went on a trip to Malaysia, had to play a game in Australia, in Perth. And then we went on to Malaysia for a week there and a week there. And we all watched that game. So it was whatever year that was. I think it was that end of my first season. And I'd had a few run-ins with Doc. And I couldn't drink cold tea. I was hopeless. The lads could drink and I was hopeless. So I'm drinking games with Gary Phillips and banging into the Chinese and all that was built into the hotel. And Doc was like the other side of it having a meal. He was getting the hump with us. So the lads always had us up singing. And I'd been up singing and... Anyway, the doc was a little bit jealous, I think, because I was a better singer and entertainer than him. And the lads loved it when I got up, like, and I was having a bit of chanter. But there was a band on the stage, and Doc was saying, I'm going to fucking bed. Don't you dare get up. You wake me up. All right, gaffer. About 10 minutes later, I'm up on the stage with Jimmy singing all night long, Ryan Ritchie. It must have been all night long, the song, because Jimmy's doing like the backing. Jimmy's just stood there going, all night, all night, all night. And I'm going, all night. I'm giving all the big licks with this band. Gets right at the end of the song. Doc comes and grabs us off the stage, pulls us off the stage, giving a little wave to the punters and that, and then drags us up to his room. He's got a lovely big suite, but he's got two beds. So he's got a bed here, and a bed there. So he drags us up. Les, who was like the doc sort of right-hand man, let's say. Les goes up, but Jimmy Carter comes up with me because Jimmy's like my buddy, you know what I mean? So Jimmy's come to give me some backing. So anyway, Jimmy says, it's unbelievable, Steve. He tells us the next day, because what I did, he says, you come in, he's on that bed, the doc, Les is here on that chair, I'm on that chair, you're on there. He says, you listen to the doc for about 2 minutes. He says, he's been battering you for half an hour. He says, but he hasn't clocked it. I've clocked it. You fell asleep after 5 minutes. Totally didn't hear a thing he said. Fell asleep on his bed, like the bed next to him.
Gets
up the next day.
He was good mates with
Doc's asleep in his bed. Creeps out, gets back into my room.
Oh my god.
He says, honestly, he says, I wish you'd been awake to see it. He says, he's battering you, Les is fucking having a go at you and saying, you should have done this. You should listen to the manager and all that. He says, next thing you just hear. Just snored the dog off. didn't mean to disrespect him, but just almost been very tired.
Yeah, he must have been tired after a 2 minute bollocking. You said then you was good mates with Jimmy Carter.
Yeah.
I always wonder about that, obviously, because you played in the same position. Did that not?
Jimmy played on the right and I played on the left a lot. And I think, yeah, we were competitive, but we respected each other. And, you know, Jimmy was, you know, obviously lightning fast and different type of way player to me. Always respected how each other played. Jimmy used to like the sort of wing player that I had. Mm. Different probably type of wing player that I did. I used to probably have to be people who were more trickery and, you know, dropping the shoulder a bit, and Jimmy could just knock it and run. And so we're different types, you know, I think. And yeah. But we're sort of, them days you played a lot of 4-4-2, so you always play with like a couple of hard working wingers, and we tend to work, did our job up and down. And so we did play a lot of games, especially in the championship. We played a lot of games together.
Mm.
On each, you know, on the opposite sides. We're both capable of switching over, and I could go back the right or the left, you know, vice versa. So, but no, me and Jimmy still keep in touch now. Got a client off Jimmy, actually, Anthony Hook, down Accomplished Contract Services. It's one of my clients I've got for me new company I've got. Sell disinfectants and sanitizers. Anthony Hook's Millwall fan, so Jimmy got him in touch with us, and he's been buying some products off us. So, yeah.
So well, how did you start the company up?
I started about, my son's got his own franchise, Zero Dry Time, and they got these couple of products in there. One's like it's a 250 tea tree fragrance, but it's a room a fogger. You sort of shake it, set it off in your room, fully depress it, mist goes up, kills everything it lands on in the room. So it's like a log 6 kill. Kills coronavirus, so
I was just about to say it's a good sign to have a company on there.
Special discount for Millwall fans to go on germ-freesolutions.co.uk. I'll look after them. Tell them to start a chat, and if they are Millwall fans, I'll look after them.
I will do, mate. Definitely.
Yeah, so Jimmy's helped us out with that one. So Horney's a client. Horney's took a case off us for his business, because Horney does Honey's got he does the football events abroad and teams travel, and he'll have told you when he was had his, you know,
do
like little trips and, you know, training camps and all that. So he's worried about like the coronavirus. He wants to go and do, set them off in the rooms before, and then set them off in the bus, because it can go through vehicles as well, in the air conditioning and all that. You only got to set it off and you leave it an hour, and then you can go back in the room, you know.
Yeah, sounds good, mate. You're not involved in football anymore?
Not at the moment. Not at the moment. I'm considering one or two things, and I've got one or two people who are, if they get jobs in the near future, I want to take us with them. But, you know, I've had a good stint, to be fair. I've been in football since I left school at 16. 52 now. My right leg's like a bloody longbow. That's bandy now. So I've got no cartilage on the inside, bone on bone. So I probably could do with a little bit of a breather from it, Dan. You know what I mean? That's why I cycle. I couldn't run to save my life, but I can cycle anywhere. So I try and keep my quads up and keep myself fit, you know?
Yeah, mate, yeah. If you could pick I always ask this question at the end of the interview. If you could pick one more night out tomorrow with three of your Millwall teammates, which three would you pick?
Which three would I pick? Oh, I mean, you'd have to say Malcolm, because he's in. I would say Jimmy and Malcolm would be definite. Be a tough one then after that. I'd probably take Dawsey with us, just to make sure I got home in a taxi. Because then other two, they wouldn't even get to him. Messing in them days.
Oh, mate, he was great value, Malcolm. He sung us out in, he closed the show in Welsh. Sung No One Likes Us in Welsh when he closed the show.
Oh, he's funny. He's funny lad, Malcolm. He's a lovely lad as well.
Yeah, he was top man. Mate, it's been an absolute pleasure to have you on. I really enjoyed it and enjoyed your time at Millwall. And to this day now, I mean, your goal at Anfield, I've posted it about 7 times in the last 3 weeks because it's still talked about and still well remembered.
Oh, that's great. No, like I say, the only disappointment I ever had at Millwall was going down and then the playoffs. I really loved my time there. I wish I hadn't left. I was saying that to Dave Donovan, my mate. I wish I hadn't left in the end, but sometimes you just do. I went back there a couple of times. I actually stuck one up Millwall actually for York City. I scored a 25-yarder, and I think it was a winner. I remember, it was funny, I came out the ground and I was talking to my pal outside and they were queuing up for FA Cup tickets that had FA Cup game coming up, and they're all going, "Fucking hell, Geordie, good job we fucking like you. Scoring a goal like that, we'll let you off, son. And then I went to the playoffs with Huddersfield Town when I think Millwall won the playoffs that year. And we were just too young. We just weren't ready for that. The team was a young team, young Jordan Rhodes, Anthony Pilkington, Lee Peltier.
We beat you in the playoffs that year, didn't we?
Beat you in the playoffs. Drew at our place and 2-0 at your place. Mm. We just couldn't handle the volatility, I think, on the day. We needed probably a couple of more older heads to be able to handle that. A lot of players couldn't handle it. And I kept saying to Lee, it's not this. You should have come to the old then. He says, if you cross the ball and you got too far up the pitch, it'd boot you up the arse back on the pitch. but it was a brilliant time there. Unless I'll come back down. I mean, Jimmy was obviously working at the club and invited us down a couple of years ago with all the lads. It was brilliant. It's like I've never been away. And that's what I love about the club. It's still a real family club, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's definitely... One of the more, what's the word I'm looking for? I'm trying to say authenticity, but you know what I mean. Like,
no, I do. And I mean, there's no. I think too many of them have gone a bit too corporate and a bit too like all about getting people in with money, and there's a real working class and orderliness. You know, it's really good that they're really down to earth people, aren't they? They're like my people in Newcastle. I think we're the same. We're just. You know, just want to see. Don't want to see any boring football, like 400 passes across the defensive third. I mean, some teams don't get out of their own half now, do they? It's so boring.
I mean, the thing is, with Newcastle, it's probably the only slight difference I would say was there was a more of an expectancy of success at Newcastle. Where at Millwall, you haven't got to be the best player in the world. You just got to run your bollocks off, you know, and get stuck in.
Yeah, and you know, I think. You could take that analogy to most clubs. I think fans would, you'd win a few fans over because a lot of them now don't even run around. You know, but like I say, it was a great time. I loved it. I loved my time there. Loved the Doc. Loved Frank McClintock. Brilliant guys. Let's say to be fair, they did manage the lads really well. And it was a good, it was just a great atmosphere. The Christmas do. Christmas with the Lions was funny with Neil Ruddock trying to take off people, and there's so many good memories from there. Let's say I'll be back down again, hopefully. A little bit thinner on the top, but still skinny. I could still play, right?
That's why I asked you before we went on there as well, where you living, because you've got a great tan.
I'm still a bit white up here. I've been out on my bike, so, you know, I've got loads of...
You got your old Newcastle shirt, Obi, did that?
exactly. But I get out a lot. because I've got my own business now, you know, I've got a bit more time on my hands to do my own thing, as well as trying to keep, you know, build my network, because that's what it's about, isn't it? But I've got some good wholesale customers. Got people in all sorts of businesses, car businesses, bedroom fitting businesses, Anthony's businesses like cleaning. So I'm doing okay. I want to kick it on a bit now, but I'm enjoying it.
Well, if it helps, mate, we'll stick your website in the video description, and hopefully,
yeah,
we'll get a few Mill fans in touch.
Yeah, definitely. Anytime, be brilliant.
Sweet.
Well, it's been great talking to you, Dan. I've enjoyed it.
Yeah, thanks a lot for joining us, mate. It's been very, very, very good for me. I really loved it.
Brilliant. Brilliant.
Top man. Cheers, Steve-O.
Cheers, everyone. Is that what you do?
That's it, mate. That's perfect.
See you, pal.